Hello everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel Desire. And in today's live session, we are going to read Indian Art and Culture by the author Nitin Singhania. And in today's video lecture, we'll be starting with the first chapter. Earlier, I have read this particular chapters, and now I'm just revising it. So we'll be reading the first chapter, Indian Architecture, Sculpture and Pottery. I hope you guys are also studying along with me, and please try to stick by your study tables till the video ends. And I hope you also enjoy this particular live study session, and I wish you all have good study hours. So let's begin our study. And here I'm using some highlighters to mark out the important things, and also using some of the colorful ball pens to underline important notes, because I don't want to make any other notes out of it, because this book is sufficient enough in itself, because all the things are well written, well marked, and it's in good color. So everything is here. We don't need to because this is my personal strategy. I feel I don't have to write anything extra from this particular book. So whatever I find important, and I think that I need to revise it, and that particular thing should highlight whenever I open the book. So those particular things I highlight in this particular book. Yes, so let's begin our session. So the first section is of visual arts, and in that we are reading the first chapter, Indian Architecture, Sculpture and Pottery. The word architecture is derived from the Latin word tecton, which means builder. When the early man began to build his shelter to live in, the science of architecture started. Sculpture, on the other hand, is derived from Proto-Indo-European, PIE. The root is kel, which means to bend. Sculptures are small works of art, either handmade or with tools, and are more related to aesthetics than engineering and measurements. So there is a difference between architecture and sculpture. So what is the difference? We'll see. So the first is with relation to size and scope. In architecture, the architecture refers to the design and construction of building, and the sculpture is it is of relatively of smaller dimensions. Material used in architecture, we use mixture of various type of materials like stone, wood, glass, metal, sand, etc. In sculpture, there is a single piece of sculpture is used to make a single type of material. Principle involves study of engineering and mathematics. It requires detailed and accurate measurements. And in sculpture, it involves creativity and imagination and may not depend as heavily on the accurate measurements. Example, Taj Mahal, Red Fort, etc. And in sculpture, there is a Nataraja image, dancing girl, etc. Indian architecture. The story of Indian art and architecture is a story of evolution from an ancient Indus Valley civilization to the British rule. The buildings and the sculptures have a narrative of their own. The emergence and decay of great empires, the invasion of foreign rulers who gradually became indigenous, the consonance of different culture and style, etc., all are reflected in the evolution of Indian architecture and sculpture. So our Indian art and architecture has been evolved from the Indus Valley civilization till the British rule, and it's also emerging right now also. So there is a classification of Indian architecture, and it is एंशंट इंडिया, हरप्पन आर्ट, मौर्यन आर्ट, पोस्ट मौर्यन आर्ट, गुप्ता एज एंड साउथ इंडियन आर्ट. एंड इन मेडिवल इंडिया इट इज डिवाइडेड एज दिल्ली सल्तनत, मुगल आर्ट. इन मॉडर्न इंडिया इट इज इंडो गॉथिक स्टाइल एंड न्यू रोमन स्टाइल, बिकॉज ब्रिटिशर्स फॉरेनर्स केम, सो दिस पर्टिकुलर आर्ट ऑल्सो डेवलप्ड ओवर हियर. सो विल स्टार्ट विथ एंशंट इंडिया एंड विल स्टार्ट विथ हरप्पन आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चर. अ फ्लरिशिंग सिविलाइजेशन इमर्ज्ड ऑन द बैंक्स ऑफ द रिवर इंडस इन द सेकेंड हाफ ऑफ द थर्ड मिलेनियम BCE एंड स्टार्टेड अक्रॉस लार्ज पार्ट्स ऑफ द नॉर्थ वेस्टर्न एंड वेस्टर्न इंडिया. दिस इज वॉट इज नोन एज हरप्पन सिविलाइजेशन और इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन. सो डोंट कंफ्यूज हरप्पन सिविलाइजेशन और इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन. अ मार्क्ड फीचर ऑफ दिस एंशियंट सिविलाइजेशन वॉज विविड इमेजिनेशन एंड आर्टिस्टिक सेंसिबिलिटीज एक्सूडेड बाई द न्यूमरस स्कल्पचर, सील्स, पॉटरीज, ज्वेलरीज एक्सेट्रा फाउंड ऑन द एक्सकेवेशन साइट. हरप्पा एंड मोहनजोदारो, द टू मेजर साइट्स ऑफ द सिविलाइजेशन, आर अमंग द अर्लीस्ट एंड फाइनेस्ट एग्जाम्पल ऑफ अर्बन सिविक प्लानिंग. The planned network of roads, houses, and drainage system indicate the planning and engineering skills that developed during those times. Some of the important sites of Indus Valley Civilization and their archaeological findings. Harappa in pres it is presently in Pakistan on the bank of River Ravi. Two rows of six granaries with big platform, stone symbols of Lingam and Yoni, mother goddesses sculpture, wheat and barley in wooden mortar dies, copper scale and mirror, Murewa sculpture of dog chasing a deer in bronze metal, and a red sandstone male torso has been excavated. In Mohenjo-daro, it is presently present in Pakistan on the river of on the river Indus. The citadel, the great bath, the great granary, post cremation burial, sculpture of a bearded priest, the famous bronze statue of dancing girl, and the Pashupati seal. Dholapira in Gujarat, a giant water reservoir, unique water harnessing system, stadium, dams, and embankments. Inscription comprising of 10 large size signs like advertisement board. It is latest IVC city to be discovered. Lothal, Manchester of Indus Valley Civilization in Gujarat, important site of for naval trade, had a dockyard, rice husk, fire altars, painted jar, modern day chests, terracotta figures of horse and ship, instruments for measuring 95 for 90, 45 and 180 degree angles, practice of burial of cremated remains. So all these are the important sites of Indus Valley Civilization, and there are also mentioning of, yes, so a lot of prelims based questions can be asked about findings will be there, and it can be asked which of the site is, yes, it's important. Similarly, this Rakhigiri in Haryana is considered to be the largest site of Indus Valley Civilization. Granary, cemetery, drains, terracotta bricks have been found over here, and it is also called provincial capital of Harappan civilization. So Rakhigiri is the provincial capital of Harappan civilization. Roper is located in the banks of the on the banks of River Satluj in Punjab, India. A dog buried with human in oval pit burial. Copper axe was also found. Roper is the first Harappan site of independent India, first site to be excavated after independence. So it is also very important. Balthal and Kalibagan in Rajasthan, bangle factory, toy carts, bone of camel, decorated brick citadel, and lower town fire altars, all these things are found. Banawali in Haryana on the dried up Saraswati River, toy plow, barley grains, lapsi loosely, fire altars, oval shaped settlement, only city with radial streets and oval shaped settlements. Amalgiripur in Meerut, Uttar Pradesh. On the rivers of on the river bank of Yamuna, easternmost site of IVC. इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन मेजर फाइंडिंग्स आर ब्रोकन ब्लेड मेड अप ऑफ कॉपर सिरामिक आइटम्स एंड इम्प्रेशन ऑफ क्लॉथ ऑन अ ड्रो. मेहरगढ़ इज इन पाकिस्तान कंसिडर्ड अ प्रोसिक्यूसर ऑफ इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन. पॉटरी कॉपर टूल्स हैज बीन फाउंड ओवर देयर. चुन चुदारो इज लोकेटेड इन प्रेजेंट डे पाकिस्तान. ओनली इंडस सिटी विदाउट अ सितादल बीड मेकिंग फैक्ट्री एंड यूज ऑफ लिपस्टिक्स हैज बीन फाउंड ओवर देयर. फोर्ट दिजी लोकेटेड इन प्रेजेंट डे पाकिस्तान. टार स्टैचूज ऑफ बुल एंड मदर गॉडेसेस हैव बीन एक्सक्यूटेड फ्रॉम हियर. सुप्टांगडोर वेस्टर्न मोस्ट साइट ऑफ द इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन लोकेटेड इन पाकिस्तान. बैंगल्स ऑफ क्ले हैज बीन फाउंड ओवर हियर. बालू इट इज इन हरियाणा. वेरियस प्लांट रिमेन्स हैज बीन फाउंड ओवर हियर. अर्लीस्ट एविडेंस ऑफ गार्लिक. दाइमाबाद महाराष्ट्र. सदर्न मोस्ट साइट ऑफ इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन. ब्रॉन्ज स्कल्पचर्स इंक्लूडिंग ब्रॉन्ज चैरियट हैज बीन डिस्कवर्ड ओवर हियर. यस अदर प्रोमिनेंट साइट्स ऑफ इंडस वैली इंक्लूड मेहरगढ़ पाकिस्तान. दैसलापुर गुजरात. पभूमाथ गुजरात. रामपुर गुजरात. शिखरपुर गुजरात. सनौली यूपी. कुनाल हरियाणा. कानपुरा राजस्थान. पंजाब. आर्किटेक्चर इन हरप्पन सिविलाइजेशन. द रिमेन्स ऑफ हरप्पा एंड मोहनजोदारो रिवील्स अ रिमार्केबल सेंस ऑफ टाउन प्लानिंग. द टाउन वर लेड आउट इन अ रेक्टेंगुलर ग्रिड पैटर्न. द रोड रन इन नॉर्थ साउथ एंड ईस्ट वेस्ट डायरेक्शंस एंड कट ईच अदर एट राइट एंगल्स. मेनली थ्री टाइप ऑफ बिल्डिंग्स हैव बीन फाउंड इन दिस एक्सकेवेशन साइट्स. ड्वेलिंग हाउसेस. पब्लिक बिल्डिंग्स एंड पब्लिक पार्क्स. The Harappans used burnt mud bricks of standardized dimensions for the purpose of construction. Many layers of well-baked bricks were laid out and then joined together using gypsum mortar. The city was divided into two parts, an upraised citadel and the lower part. So this is the upraised citadel and the lower part. The upraised citadel in the western part was used for constructing buildings of large dimensions such as granaries, administrative buildings, pillared halls, and courtyard. Some of the buildings in the citadel might have been the residence of the rulers and aristocrats. However, Indus Valley civilization sites do not have a large monumental structures such as temples or places of rulers, unlike Egyptian and Mesopotamian civilization. The granaries were intelligently designed with a strategic air ducts and raised platform, which helped to store of grains and protecting them from pest. An important feature of the Harappan cities is the prevalence of public baths. Which is indicate the importance of ritualistic cleansing in their culture. These baths also had an array of galleries and rooms surrounding it. The most famous example of public bath is the Great Bath, and it is excavated remain of Mohenjo-daro. So this is the image. In the lower part of the city, small one-roomed houses has been found, which might have been used as quarters by the working people. Some of the houses have stairs which indicate they might have been a double-storied. Mostly buildings have private wells and properly ventilated bathrooms. The most striking feature of Harappan civilization is the advanced drainage system. Small drains run from each house and were connected to the large drains running alongside the main roads. The drains were covered closely to allow regular cleaning and maintenance. Cesspits were placed at were placed at regular intervals, the importance played on the importance was placed on hygiene, both personal and public, is quite impressive. Presence of wells also has been observed at many sites. Many scholars argue that the Mesopotamian people of the Tigris, Euphrates valleys called Indus Valley civilization as Meluha. Many Indus Valley seals has been found in Mesopotamia. Sculpture of Harappan civilization. The Harappan sculpture are extremely adept of handling three-dimensional volumes. The most commonly found were seals, bronze figures, and potteries. Archaeologists have found numerous seals of different shapes and sizes all across the excavation site. While most of the seals are square, it was found that the triangular, rectangular, and circular seals were also being used. Sittalite, a soft stone found in the river beds, was although the most common material used to make the seals, yet agate, chert, copper, faience, and terracotta seals have also been found. Some instances of gold and ivory seals have also been found. Most of the seals have inscriptions as a pictographic script, which is yet to be pictographic, which is yet to be deciphered. The script was written mostly from right to left, but bidirectional writing style. Right to left on one line and left to right on the other line has also been found. Animal impressions were also there, generally five, which were carved in intaglio on the surface. The common animal motifs which are found is unicorn, humped bulls, rhinoceros, tiger, elephant, buffaloes, bison, goat, Markhor, ibex, crocodile, etc. However, no evidence of cow has been found on any seal. Generally, the seals had an animal or a human figure on one side and an inscription on the opposite side, or the inscription on both the sides. Some seals and inscriptions on the third side as well. Seals were primarily used for commercial purposes and helped in the communication. Discovery of various seals in Mesopotamia and various sites such as Lothal indicate the seals are extensively used for trade. The seals were extensively used for trade. Some seals with a hole on them have been found on the dead bodies, indicating it's a use as amulets carried on the person of their owners, probably seen as some form of indication. Mathematical images have been also found on some seals, which might have been used for educational purposes as well. Seals with symbols similar to swastika design have also been found. Famous seal includes the Pashupati seal and unicorn seal. Pashupati seal. Pashupati seal. A seal discovered at Mohenjo-daro depicts a human figure or a deity sitting cross-legged. The figure, referred as a Pashupati, wears a three-horned headgear and is surrounded by the animals. An elephant and a tiger are there on the left side of the figure, while a rhinoceros and a buffalo are seen on the right side. Two antelopes are shown below in the seat of the figure. Bronze figure. The Harappan civilization saw a wide scale of practice of bronze casting. The bronze statues were made using of low wax technique or cire brute. In this technique, wax figures are first coated with a wet clay and allowed to dry. The clay coated figures are then heated, allowing the wax inside to melt. The wax is then poured out through a tiny hole and the liquid metal is poured inside the hollow mold. After the metal has cooled down, the solidified, the clay coat is removed and the metal figure of the same shape of the wax is obtained. Even now, the same technique is practiced in many parts of the country. For example, a bronze dancing girl of Mohenjo-daro, bronze bull of Kalibangan, etc. The Dancing Girl is the world's oldest bronze sculpture found in Mohenjo-daro. This is a 4-inch figure depicts a naked girl wearing only garments which include bangles on the left arm and amulet and bracelets on the right arm. She stands in a Tribhanga dancing posture with the right hand on her hip. Terracotta. Terracotta refers to the use of fire-baked clay for making sculptures compared to that of the bronze figures. The terracotta sculptures found are less in number and crude in shape and form. They were made using pinching methods and have been found mostly in the sites of Gujarat and Kalibagan. For example, Mother Goddess, mask of horned deities, toys, etc. The Mother Goddess figures has been found in many Indus sites, which highlights its importance. It's a crude figure of a standing female adorned with a necklace hanging over prominent breast. She wears a launchi cloth and a girdle. She also wears a fan-shaped headgear. The facial features are also shown very crudely and lacks fineness. She was probably worshipped for prosperity. She might also have been a goddess of fertility cults. Bearded priest found in Mohenjo-daro and made of stelite. It is the figure of a bearded man draped in the shawl and trefoil patterns. The eyes are elongated and half closed, as in it is in the meditation. Red sandstone figure of a male torso found in the Harappa and made up of red sandstone. The torso has a frontal posture with well-baked shoulders and a prominent abdomen. There is a socket holes in the neck and the shoulder, probably for the attachment of the head and the arms. Pottery. The potteries found at the excavation sites can be broadly classified into two kinds, plain pottery and painted pottery. The painted pottery is also known as the red and black pottery, and it is used red color to paint on the background, and the glossy black has been used to draw designs and figures on the red background. Trees, birds, animal figures, and geometrical patterns were recurring themes of these paintings. Most of the potteries that have been found are very fine, wheel-made wares, with a very few being handmade. Some example of polychrome pottery have also been found over here, though very rare. The potteries were used for three main purposes. First, plain pottery was used for household purpose, mainly to store grains and water. Miniature vessels, generally less than half an inch in size, were used for decorative purposes. Some of the potteries were perforated with large holes in the bottom and small holes across in the side, and they might have been used for straining liquor. Ornaments. The Harappan used a large variety of materials, from precious metals and gemstones to bones and even baked clay to make ornaments. Both men and women wore ornaments like necklaces, fillets, armlets, and finger rings. Girdles, earrings, anklets were also worn by the women. Beads made from carnelian, amethyst, quartz, stelite, etc., were quite popular and were produced in large scale, as it is evident from the factories discovered in the Chunchudaro and Lothal. For fabric, the Harappans used cotton and wool, which were spun by rich and poor alike. The people of the time were conscious of fashion as well, as can be inferred from the different styles of hair and beard. Mauryan art and architecture. With the advent of Buddhism and Jainism, which were part of Sharmana tradition, the religious and social scenarios of gigantic valleys began to undergo change as both of the religions were opposed to the Varna and Jati system of Vedic age. They gained patronage of the Kshatriya rulers who had grown wary of Brahmanical supremacy. As the Mauryans established their power, a clear demarcation can be seen of architecture and sculptures developed by these state patronage and those that were developed by the individual initiative. Thus, Mauryan art can be classified as follow. So Mauryan art. So there is a court art, court initiative. So there are palaces, pillars, stupas. And the second is popular art, which is individual initiatives. So it has caves, pottery, and sculptures. So we will see first court art. The Mauryan rulers commissioned a large number of architectural works of political as well as religious reasons. These works are referred to as court art. Palaces. The Mauryan Empire was first powerful empire to come to power in India. The capital at Pataliputra and the places at Kumrahar were created to reflect the splendor of the Mauryan Empire. The place of Chandragupta Maurya, the palace of Chandragupta Maurya, was inspired by the Archimede places of Perolipois in Iran. Wood was the principal building material. Megasthenes described the place as one of the great creations of mankind. This is the site. Similarly, Ashoka's palace at Kumarhar was a massive structure. It had a high central pillar and was a three-story wooden structure. The palace walls were decorated with carvings and sculptures. Pillars. During the region of Ashoka, the inscription on pillars as the symbols of the state or to commemorate a battle victories assumed a great significance. He also used pillars to propagate imperial sermons as well. On an average, 40 feet height of the pillar were usually made of Chunar sandstone and comprised of shaft and capital. A long shaft formed on the base was made up of a single piece of the stone or the monolith. On top of it lays the capital, which is either of lotus shaped or bell shaped. The bell shaped capitals were influenced by the Iranian pillars and was the highly polished and lustrous finish of the pillars. Above it, there was a circular and or rectangular base known as the abacus, on which animal figure was placed. So, basic structure of Ashokan pillar. So, there is a monolithic shaft, a capital is there, and the capital, there is a bell shaped or lotus shaped bottom, abacus is there, and on top of it, animal figure was present. Yes. Lauriya Nandagra pillar in Champaran, Sarnath pillar near Varanasi. National emblem. The abacus and the animal part of the Sarnath pillar forms the official national emblem of India. The abacus of the Sarnath pillar, four animals are shown representing four directions: a galloping horse at the west, an elephant in the east, a bull in the south, and the lion in the north. Animals seems to follow each other, turning the wheel of existence till eternity. The elephant depicts the dream of Queen Maya, where the white elephant entering her womb. The bull depicts the zodiac sign of Taurus, the mouth in which the Buddha was born. The horse represents the horse of Kanthakata, which Buddha is said to have used for going away from princely life. The lion shows attainment of enlightenment. In the national emblem of India, the word Satyameva Jayate from Mundaka Upanishad, meaning truth alone triumphs, are inscribed below the abacus in Devanagari script. The capital is crowned with the wheel of the law, Dharma Chakra. The four lions symbolizes Buddha spreading Dharma in all directions. It was built in the commemoration of the first sermon of Buddha known as Dhamma Chakra प्रव्रताना धमा चक्रा पर्वतराना. Stupas were burial molds prevalent in India from the Vedic period. It is a conventional representation of a funeral columnus in which relics and ashes of the dead were kept. During the period of Ashoka, the art of stupas reached its climax. Almost 84,000 stupas were created during this period. Although a Vedic tradition, stupas were popularized by Buddhists after the death of Buddha. 9 stupas were created. 8 of them had relics of Buddhas in their Medhi, while the 9th had pot in which the relics were originally kept. A basic diagram representing the various parts of the stupas are given below. So diagram is here. So there is a double stairway, south torana, stone fence, east torana, west torana. Okay, these are the pillars over there. There is a up level walkway or a passage. There is a stupa dome. On top of it, there is a harmika, yashti, and chhatras. The core of the stupa was made up of unburnt bricks, while the outer surface was made by using burnt bricks, which was were then covered with a thick layer of plaster. The Medhi and the Toran were decorated with wooden sculptures. Devotees walk around the Pradakshina path or the open ambulatory passageway as a token of worship. There is a good example of stupa, which is Sanchi Stupa in Madhya Pradesh is the most famous of the Ashokan stupas. Sanchi Stupa in Madhya Pradesh is the most famous of the Ashokan stupas. Piprava stupas in Uttar Pradesh is the oldest one. The location of the nine stupas built after the death of the Buddhas are Rajigra, Vaishali, Kapilvastu, Alakappa, Ramagrama, Vettipeda, Pava, Kushengar, and Piplavana. Difference between Ashokan pillars and Achaemenian pillars. So there is a difference in composition. The shaft of the Ashokan pillar were monolithic. Example, they were inscribed from a single piece of stone, mainly of Chunar sandstones. Achaemenian pillars, or the shaft of Achaemenian pillars, were made up of various types of sandstones cemented together. Location. The Ashokan pillars were independently erected. Achaemenian pillars were generally attached to state buildings. Popular art. Apart from royal patronage, cave architecture, sculpture, and pottery took the expressions of art and individual effort. These were grouped together as the popular forms of arts and architecture. Cave architecture. This period saw the emergence of rock-cut cave architectures. During the Mauryan period, these caves were generally used as viharas, a living quarters by the Jain and Buddhist monks, while the early caves were used by Ajivika sect. Later, they became popular as Buddhist monasteries. The caves during the Mauryan period were marked as the highly polished finish in their interior walls and decorative gateways. Example, Barabar and Nagarjuni caves in Bihar were formed during this time of Ashoka and his grandson Dashrata, and dates back to 3rd century BC. Nasik caves. In the group of 24 Buddhist caves, also known as Pandav Leni, they were caved between 1st century BC and 3rd century AD and belong to the Hinayana period. However, later the influence of Mahayana sect can also be found in these caves. Under the Hinayana sect, Buddha's presence is indicated through the use of motifs and symbols like thorn and throne and footprints, and later the ideas of Buddhas were also carved inside the caves, representing the influence of Mahayana Buddhism. The site also depicts an excellent system of water management, indicating through the presence of water tanks and carved out solid rocks. Sculpture. Sculptures were used primarily for the decoration of stupas in the Torna and Medhi as in the form of religious expression. Two of the famous sculptures of the Mauryan period are those Yaksha and Yakshi. They were objects of worship related to all the three religions, Jainism, Hinduism and Buddhism. The earliest mention of Yakshi can be found in Shilpadikaram, a Tamil text. Similarly, all those the Jain Tirthankars were also associated with Yakshi. Pottery. So this is the Yakshi sculpture of Yaksha. Pottery. Pottery of the Mauryan period is generally referred as the northern black polished ware. They were characterized by the black paint and highly lustrous finish and were generally used as a luxury item. They have been often been referred to as the highest level of pottery. Specimen of black polished ware. So here we'll be taking a 3 minutes break, and after it we'll start post Mauryan art. Hello everyone, so I'm back from the break and we'll start with the Mauryan, post-Mauryan art. After the decline of Mauryan Empire in 2nd century BCE, small dynasties sprang up in various parts of India, among them Shungas, Kanvas, Kushnas and Shakas in the west, and Satavahanas, Ikshvakus, Abiras and Vaktakas in the southern and western India gained prominence. Similarly, the religious scene saw the emergence of Brahminical sects such as Shaivites, Vaishnavites, Shaktivis, the art of this period started reflecting in the changing socio-political scenario as well. The architecture in the form of rock-cut caves and stupas continued with each dynasty, introducing some unique features of their own. Similarly, different schools of sculpture emerged, and their art of sculpture reached its climax as in the post-Mauryan period. Architecture. In architecture, we'll see rock-cut caves. The construction of rock caves continued in the Mauryan period. However, the period saw the development of two types of rock caves, Chaitra and Vihara. While the Viharas were residential halls of Buddhist and Jain monks and were developed during the time of Mauryan Empire, the Chaitya halls were developed during this time. They were mainly quadrangular chambers with flat roof and used as a prayer halls. The caves also had open courtyards and stone screen walls to shield from rain. They were also decorated with human and animal figures. Example, Kale Chaitya Hall, Ajanta Caves. 29 caves are there, in which 25 are Viharas and 4 are Chaityas. Udaygiri and Khandagiri Caves, Odisha. They were made under the Kalinga King Kharavela in 1st and 2nd century BCE near the modern day Bhubaneswar. The cave complex has both artificial and natural caves. They were possibly carved out of a residence of Jain monks. There are 18 caves in Udaynagiri and 15 in Khandagiri. Udaygiri caves are famous for Hathi Gumba inscription, which is carved out of a Brahmi script. The inscription starts out with a Jain Namokar mantra and highlights the various military campaigns undertaken by the king Karavela. Rani Gumba cave in Udaynagiri is a double storied and has some beautiful sculptures. Stupas became larger and more decorative in post-Mauryan period. Stones were increasingly used in place of wood and brick. The Shunga dynasty introduced the idea of torans as beautifully decorated gateways to the stupas. The torans were intricately carved with figures and patterns, and they were evidence of a Hellenistic influence. Bharuch Sutta in Madhya Pradesh, toran in Sanchi stupa in the Madhya are the, some of the examples. Sculptures. Three prominent schools of sculpture developed in this particular period, and there are three different religions of India centered at Gandhar, Mathura, Amravati. Gandhara school. The Gandhara school of art developed in the western frontiers of Punjab near the modern day Peshawar and Afghanistan. The Greek invaders brought with them traditions of the Greek and Roman sculptors, which influenced the local traditions and region of the region. Thus, Gandhara school is also came to be known as Greco-Indian school of art. The Gandhara school flourished in two stages in this period from 50 BC to 500 AD. While the former school was known for its use of bluish gray sandstone, the later school used mud and stucco for making the sculptures. The images of Buddha and Buddhitsa were based on Greco-Roman pantheon and resembled that of Apollo. Mathura school. The Mathura school flourished on the banks of River Yamuna in the period between 1st and 3rd century AD. The sculpture of the Mathura schools were influenced by the stories and imaginations of all the three religions of the time, Buddhism, Hinduism, and Jainism. The images were modeled on the earlier Yaksha images and found during the Mauryan period. The Mathura school showed a striking use of symbolism in the images. The Hindu gods were represented using the Ayudhas. For example, Shiva is shown through Linga, Mukha Linga. Similarly, the halo around the head of the Buddha is larger than the Gandhara school and decorated with geometrical patterns. The Buddha is shown to the surroundings by two Bodhisattvas, Padmapani holding a lotus and Vajrapani holding thunderbolt. Amravati school. in southern part of India, Amravati school developed in the banks of on the bank of the Krishna River under the patronage of the Sathavahana rulers, while the other two schools focused on single images. Amravati school put more emphasis on the use of dynamic images or narrative art. The sculptures of this school made excessive use of Tribhanga posture, example the body with three bends. Differences between Gandharva, Mathura and Amravati schools. External influence. Firstly, the Gandhara school had a heavy influence of Greek or Hellenistic culture, so it was also known as Indo-Greek art. The Mathura school, it was developed indigenously and not influenced by any external culture. The Amravati school was developed indigenously and not influenced by external cultures. Gandhara school, the ingredients used is the early Gandhara school used bluish gray sandstone, while the later period saw the use of mud and stucco. In Mathura school, the structures of Mathura school were made out of spotted red stone, and in Amravati school, the structure, the sculptures of Amravati schools were made out of white marbles. Religious influence. The Gandhara school mainly Buddhist imaginary influenced by Greco-Roman pantheon. Mathura influence of all the three religions, Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism, and Amravati mainly Buddhist influenced. Patronage. Gandhara school was patronized by Kushina, Mathura by Kushina, and it was Amravati by area of development. Gandhara developed on the northwestern frontier in the modern day area Gandhar. Mathura developed around Mathura, Shonk and Kanka. Litila was famous for Jain sculptures. Amravati developed in Krishna Godavari lower valley and around Amravati and Nagarjuna Konda. Features of Buddha sculptures. In Gandhara, the Buddha is shown in spiritual state with a wavy hair. He wears fewer ornaments and seated in a yogi position. The eyes are half closed as in meditation. A protuberance is shown on the head signifying omniscience of the Buddha. Mathura. Buddha is shown in delighted mood with a smile, with a smiling face. The body symbolizes masculinity, wearing a tight dress. The face and the head are shaven. Buddha is seated in Padmasana with a different mudras, and his face reflects grace and similar protuberance as shown in on the head. Amravati, since the sculptures are generally part of the narrative art, they are less emphasis on the individual features of the Buddha. The sculptures generally depicts the life stories of the Buddha and the Jataka tales, the previous lives of the Buddhas in both human and animal form. This is which is in Gandhara, Mathura and Amravati. Greek art and Roman art. Greek and Roman styles have some differences, and the Gandhara school integrates both the styles. The idealistic style of Greek is reflected in the muscular depictions of gods and other men showing strength and beauty. Lots of Greek mythological figures from the Greek Parthenon have been sculpted using marble. So there is a lot of similarity. On the other hand, Romans used arts of ornamentation and decoration and in realistic in nature are opposed to Greek idealism. Roman art projects realism and depicts real people and major historical events. Romans used concrete in their sculptures. They were also famous for their mural paintings. So there are various mudras related to Buddha. Bhumi Sparsha, Dhyana, Vitarka, Abhya, Dharmachakra, Anjali, Uthar Bodhi, Vardha, करना वज्रा, नॉवल स्टडी गुप्ता एज। द इमर्जेंस ऑफ गुप्ता एम्पायर इन 4th century AD इज ऑफन हेल्ड एज द गोल्डन एज ऑफ इंडिया। वाइल द अर्लियर गुप्ता रूलर्स वर बुद्धिस्ट एंड कंटिन्यूड द ट्रेडिशंस ऑफ बुद्धिस्ट आर्किटेक्चर, टेम्पल ट्रेडिशन आर्किटेक्चर केम टू द फोरफ्रंट अंडर द पेट्रोनेज ऑफ द हिंदू रूलर्स ऑफ द लेटर गुप्ता फेज। टेम्पल आर्किटेक्चर रीच्ड इट्स क्लाइमेक्स ड्यूरिंग द पीरियड। सिमिलरली बुद्धिस्ट एंड जैन आर्ट ऑल्सो रीच्ड इट्स पीक ड्यूरिंग द गुप्ता एज। द गुप्ता रूलर्स स्पेशली द लेटर फेज वर ब्राह्मिनिकल रूलर्स, हाउएवर दे शोड एग्जेम्पलरी टॉलरेंस फॉर ऑल अदर रिलीजन्स। थ्री प्रिंसिपल डेटीज वर्शिप्ड वर विष्णु इन द नदर्न एंड सेंट्रल पार्ट्स ऑफ द इंडिया, शिवा इन द सदर्न पार्ट एंड शक्ति इन द ईस्टर्न पार्ट्स ऑफ द इंडिया एज वेल एज मालाबार कोस्ट ऑफ साउथ वेस्ट पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया। आर्किटेक्चर केव्स ड्यूरिंग द गुप्ता पीरियड आर्किटेक्चर डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द केव्स रिमेन्ड कॉन्स्टेंट। हाउएवर द यूज ऑफ म्यूरल पेंटिंग्स ऑन द वॉल्स ऑफ द केव्स बिकेम एडेड फीचर। Some of the finest example of mural paintings can be found in the caves of Ajanta and Ellora. Ajanta Caves. Ajanta is a series of rock-cut caves in the Sahyadri range of Waghora River near Aurangabad in Maharashtra. There are total 29 caves, thereof which 25 were used as viharas or residential caves, while 4 were used as chaitra or prayer halls. The caves were developed in the period between 200 BC to 650 AD, probably. The Ajanta caves were inscribed by Buddhist monks under the patronage of Vataka kings, Harisena being a prominent one. The figures in these caves were made using fresco paintings techniques and demonstrate considerable naturalism. The color were obtained from the local vegetation and minerals. The outlines of the paintings were done in red color and the inside were painted. On the striking features, the absence of blue color in the paintings. Cave number 16 is one of the most elegant specimens of the cave architecture. The painting are generally themed around Buddhism, the life of Buddha and the Jatak stories of 29 caves. 5 are developed during the Hinayana phase, while the remaining 24 were developed during Mahayana phase of Buddhism. Reference of Ajanta caves can be found in the travel accounts of Chinese Buddhist travelers, Fahen and Yuan Song. Some prominent sculptures of Ajanta caves are Mahaparinirvana of Buddha in cave number 26, Naga King in his concert in cave number 19. Techniques of painting. The paintings were done using fresco method. It involved three-step technique. A layer of clay mixed with cow dung and rice husk was applied on the surface of the rock. A coating of lime plaster was then applied on top of it. Colors and pigments were then applied on the moist surface. This allowed the pigments to seep in and create lasting image of the rock surface. For example, dying princesses, flying apsara, etc. Fresco is a technique of mural painting executed upon the freshly laid wet lime plaster. It is closely associated with Italian Renaissance painting. Ellora Caves. Ellora Caves are another important site of cave architecture. It is located nearly 100 kilometers away from Ajanta Caves. It is a group of 34 caves, 17 Brahminical, 12 Buddhist, and 5 Jain. This set of caves are developed during the period between 5th and 11th centuries AD, newer as compared to Ajanta caves by various glides from Vidarbha, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu. Hence, the caves reflect naturally diversity in terms of themes and architecture style. Cave 1 to 12 are Buddhist, cave number 13 to 29 are Hindu, and cave 30 to 34 are Jain, Digambara sect. The Hindu and Buddhist caves were predominantly constructed by Rashtrakuta dynasty and Jain caves by Yadava dynasty. Some of the prominent caves in Ellora are cave number 10. A Buddhist Chaitya cave known as Vishwakarma cave or Carpenter's cave. Buddha is seated in the Dharma Chakra Mudra, here with the Bodhi tree carved at the back. Cave number 14, themed Ravan ki Khai. Cave number 15, Dashavatar Temple. Cave number 16, Kailasha Temple, dedicated to Lord Shiva. It was developed under the patronage of Rashtrakuta King Krishna I and was carved out of a monolith and even has a courtyard. Cave number 16 is also a sculpture, has a sculpture on his wall of Kailash Temple depicting Ravana shaking Mount Kailasha. It is considered as one of the masterpiece of Indian sculpture. Tumhar Lena Cave, and it is of 29 number. Rameshwar Lena Cave, 21. Two famous Jain caves are Indra Sabha cave number 32 and Jagannath Sabha cave number 33. Bagh Caves, located on the bank of Baghini River in Madhya Pradesh. It is a group of nine Buddhist caves developed around 5th and 6th century AD. It is architecturally very similar to Ajanta caves. Most significant caves here is Rang Mahal. Paintings in Bagh caves are more materialistic rather than spiritualistic. Junagadh caves. So there is a Buddhist cave located in Junagadh district of Gujarat. In place of caves, three different sites can be found. Karpa, Kodia, Baba Pyare, Uparkot. A unique feature of the Junagadh cave is presence of a 30 to 50 feet high citadel known as Uparkot in front of the prayer hall. Madha Peshawar caves, located in Borivali near Mumbai, is also known as Montpierre caves. It is developed in the late Gupta period as Brahminical caves. However, it was later converted into Christian caves. The remains of the site include sculptures of Nataraja, Sadashiva, Ardhanarishvara. The church and its graveyard are situated above the cave crescent. Udaygiri caves, not to be confused with Udayagiri Kandagiri caves in Odisha. It is located in Vidisha, Madhya Pradesh, created in early 5th century AD under the patronage of Chandragupta II. It is famous for having numerous sculptures on the hills, on the hill walls. The sculpture of Varaha or boar incarnation on the Vishnu is notable. The caves has one of the earliest Hindu sculptures. It also have cave dedicated to Shiva, Narasimha, half lion, half man, Narayana resting, Vishnu and Skanda. Stupas. The Gupta age saw a decline in the development of stupas. However, Dhamek Stupa at Sarnath near Varanasi is a fine example of stupa developed during this particular period. It is marked as the spot where Buddha gave his first sermon. Sculptures. During the Gupta period, a new school of sculpture was developed around Sarnath. It was characterized by the use of cream-colored sandstone and the use of metal. The sculptures of these schools were immaculately dressed and lacked any form of nakedness. The hollow around the head of Buddha was intricately decorated. Example. Sultanganj Buddha, 7.5 feet in height in Bihar, is a copper sculpture. Temple architecture. Temple architecture with the development of a square sanctum and the parallel portico emerged during the Gupta period. There was a gradual progression from flat-roofed monolithic temples in the initial stages to the sculptured shikhara in the later years. The progression can be distinguished into five stages. First stage, the features of the temple that developed during this phase are: the temple has a flat roof, the temples were square in shape, the portico was developed on shallow pillars, the entire structure was built on low platform. Like this. In second stage, the temples built during this phase continued most of the features of the earlier phase. However, the platforms were higher or upraised. Some instances of two-storied temples have also been found. Another important addition of this phase was covered emulatory passageway around the Sanctum Sanctorum or Garbhagriha. The passageway was used as a pradakshina path. For example, Parvati temple at Nachakutara in Kutahara in Madhya Pradesh. Third stage. This stage saw emergence of shikharas in place of flat roofs. However, they were still quite low and almost square. Curvilinear Panchayatan style of temple making was introduced. Panchayatan style of temple making, there were four subsidiary shrines along with the temple on the peripheral of the principal deity. The main temple was square with an elongated mandap in front of it, giving it a rectangular shape. The subsidiary shrines were placed opposite to each other on either side of the mandap, giving a ground plan a crucified shape. Example, Dashavatara temple at Deoghar, Uttar Pradesh, Durga temple at Ehole, Karnataka. Fourth stage. The temples of this stage were most similar except the main shrine became rectangular. Thir temple in Maharashtra. Fifth stage. In this stage, circular temples with shallow rectangular projections were introduced. The rest of the features of this previous phase continued. Maniyar Math at Rajgir. There are different style of temple architecture. Nagara style, Dravidian style, Nayaka style, Vairasa, Hoysala, Vijayanagara, Pala and Sena school. The basic form of Hindu temple comprises of the following. Sanctum. There are some of the basic features of Hindu temples. And it is Sanctum Sanctorum, also known as Garbhagriha, literally womb house, is a small room, generally cubical, which houses the principal deity of the temple, Mandapa. It is the entrance of the temple. It may be a portico or a hall, and is generally designed to house a large number of worshippers. Shikhara, it is a mountain-like spire. The shape varies from pyramidal to curvilinear. Vahana, it is the mount or the vehicle of the main deity and is placed just before the Sanctum Sanctorum. However, under the patronage of the local rulers, different styles of architecture developed in different regions of India. Nagara school of architecture. From 5th century AD onwards, distinct style of temple architecture developed in the northern part of India known as Nagara style of architecture. Even in the Nagara school, different sub-schools emerged in western, central and eastern parts of the country. Some of the features of Nagara styles are the temples generally followed the Panchayatana style of temple making, which considered a subsidiary shrines laid out as a crucified ground plan with respect to the principal shrine. Presence of assembly halls or mandapas in front of the principal shrine. Outside the Garbhagriha, images of the river goddesses Ganga and Yamuna were placed. Generally, there were no water tanks or reservoir presence in the temple premises. The temple were generally built on upraised platforms. The porticos had a pillared approach. Shikharas were generally of three types. Latina or Rekha Prasad, they were square at the base and the wall curves inward at the point of the top. Hamsana, they had a broader base and they were shorter in height than the Latina ones. They slope upwards on the straight line. Vallabhi, they had a rectangular base with the roof rising into the vaulted chambers, and they were also called Vegan vaulted roofs. The vertical end of the shikhara ended in the horizontal fluted disc known as the Amalak. On the top of that, a spherical shape was placed known as Kalash. Inside the temple, the walls was divided into three vertical planes or Rath. These were known as Tirtha temples, later Panchatratha, Saptatratha, and even Navaratha temples came into existence. The vertical planes were used as different panels to make narratives. Sculptures. The ambulatory passage or the Pradakshina path around the Sanctum Sanctorum was covered. Generally, the temple premises did not have any elaborate boundary walls or gateways. This is the basic structure. This is the upraised platform. Then there is a passage. Sanctum Sanctorum. A pillared approach is there, and on top of it, there is a shikhara. Under the Nagara school, following three schools are emerged Odisha school. Odisha school in different parts of the Kalinga Empire, these distinct styles of temple architecture developed. Some of these features were the exterior walls were lavishly decorated with intricate carvings, but the exterior walls were plain. There were no use of pillars in the porch. Iron grinders were used instead of support of the roof. The shikhara of the Odisha school was also known as Rekha Dwell. They were almost vertical roofs with suddenly curved inward sharply. The mandap was known as Jagmohan in this region. The ground plan of the main temple was square. The temples were surrounded by boundary walls as the Dravidian style of temple architecture. Kalash, Amalak, Bhumi, Amala, Rangpaga, and Jagmohan. Sun Temple of Konark is also known as Black Pagoda, Jagannath Temple of Puri, Lingaraja Temple at Bhuvaneshwara are example of this. Khajuraho School. In the central part of India, Chandela rulers developed a distinct style of temple making of their own known as Khajuraho School or Chandela School. The features of these temples include, in these temples, both the interior and exterior walls were lavishly decorated with carvings. The sculptures were generally erotic in their themes and drew inspiration from Vatsyayana's Kama Sutra. The temples were made of sandstone. The temples and three chambers, Garbhagriha, Mandapa, and Ardha Mandapa. Some temples had a vestibular entrance of the Garbhagriha known as Antrala. The temples were generally north or east facing. Panchayatana style of temple making was followed. The subsidiary shrines had Rekha Prasad Shikharas creating an impression of mountain range. The temple was built on relatively higher platform and belonged to Hindu as well as Jain religion. Kendriya Mahadev Temple, Lakshmana Temple at Khajuraho are examples of it. Solanki School is also known as Maru Gujara style. In the northwestern part of India, including Gujarat and Rajasthan, these schools developed under the patronage of Solanki rulers. The features of this school included the temple walls were devoid of any paintings. The Garbhagriha was connected with the Mandapa both internally as well as externally. The porticos has decorated arched gateways down as torrents. The unique feature of this school is the presence of step tanks known as Surya Kund in the proximity of the temple. The steps of the tank are full of small temples with wooden carvings present in them. The Solankis used a variety of materials to make temples, including sandstone, black basalt, and soft marble. Most of the temples are east-facing and designed in such a way that every year during equinox, the sun rays fall directly into the central shrine. Modera Sun Temple is an example of it, and it was built in 126 to 27 BC. In 27, and it was built by Bhima I. Temple architecture in South India. Just as the Nagara school of architecture with different sub-schools emerged in northern part of India, distinct style of temple architecture emerged in peninsular India as well. Temple architecture in South India began under the Pallava ruler Mahendra Varman. The temple developed during the Pala dynasty reflected the stylistic taste of the individual rulers and can be classified into four stages chronologically. Mahendra group. This was the first stage of Pallava temple architecture. The temple built under the Mahendra Varman were basically rock cut temples. Under him, the temples were known as mandapas, unlike Nagara style in which mandapas meant only the assembly hall. Narasimha group. This represented the second stage of the development of the temple architecture in South India. The rock cut temples were decorated with intricate sculptures under Narasimha Varman. The mandapas were now divided into separate rathas. The biggest one was called Dharmaraja Ratha, while the smallest one was called Draupadi Ratha. The design of the temple in the Dravidian style of architecture is a successor of the Dharmaraja Ratha. Rajasimha group. Rajasimha led the third stage of the temple development under the development of real structural temples, started a place of rock cut temples, and example are Shore Temple at Mahabalipuram, Kailashnath Temple at Kanchipuram, etc. Nandivarman group. This was the fourth stage of temple development during the Pallava period. The temple built were smaller in size. The features were almost similar to that of the Dravidian style of the temple architecture. After the decline of Pallava dynasty, temple architecture acquired a new style under the Chola kingdom known as Dravidian style. The temple architecture is marked as the new era of the development of temples in South India. In the later period, other styles, Versa style, Nayaka, Vijayanagara style also emerged in this region. Dravidian style of temple architecture, and it was developed, and it is also called Chola architecture. Under the patronage of Chola rulers, hundreds of temples were built in South India. It was a continuation of the previous Pallava architecture with some variations. This is what came to be known as Dravidian style of temple architecture. The feature of the Dravidian style of Chola architecture are, unlike the Nagara temples, Dravidian temples were surrounded by high boundary walls. The front wall had a high entrance gateway known as Gopuram. The temple premises has laid out a Panchayatan style with a principal temple and four subsidiary shrines. Under the Dravidian style, the spire is in the form of stepped pyramid that rises up linearly rather than curved. It is also known as Vimana. The crowning element is shaped in the form of an octagon, and it is also known as Shikhara. It is similar to the Kalash of the Nagara style, but it is not spherical. There is only one Vimana in the Dravidian architecture on top of the main temple. The subsidiary shrines do not have any Vimanas, unlike Nagara architecture. The assembly hall was connected with the Garbhagriha by a vestibular tunnel known as Antrala. The entrance of the Garbhagriha and the sculptures of Dwarpal, Mithun, and Yaksha. The presence of water tank inside the temple enclosures was a unique feature of the Dravidian style. Brihadeshwara Temple at Tanjavur, built by Raja Raja I in 1011 AD. Gangikonda Cholapuram Temple, built by Rajendra I to commemorate his victory in the Gangatic Delta, etc. A very simple diagram. So, water tank is there, Garbhagriha, subsidiary shrines, Gopuram, it's the entrance. Vimana is here, Antrala, a passage to Garbhagriha, assembly hall for the devotees. Chola sculpture. An important feature of Chola temples was the importance placed in the decoration through sculptures. An important piece of Chola sculpture was the sculpture of Nataraja in the Tandava dance posture. Though the earliest known Nataraja sculpture, which has been excavated at Ravanapadi cave at Elhol, was made during the early Chalukya rule, the sculpture reached its peak under the Cholas. Some of the features of the Nataraja sculpture are the upper right hand holds the drum, which signifies the sound of creation. All creation springs from the great sound of the Damru. The upper left hand holds the eternal fire, which represents destruction. Destruction is the persecutor and an inevitable counterpart of creation. The lower right hand is raised in the gesture of Abhaya Mudra, signifying benediction and reassuring the devotee not to be afraid. The lower hand points towards the upraised foot and indicates the path of salvation. Shiva is dancing in the figure on the figure of a small dwarf, and the dwarf symbolizes ignorance and the ego of an individual. The matted and flowing locks of Shiva represents the flow of the river of the Ganga. The ornamentation, one ear of Shiva has a male earring and the other had a female. This represents the fusion of male and female and is often referred as Ardhanarishwar. A snake is twisted around the arms of the Shiva. The snake symbolizes the Kundalini power, which resides in human spine in dormant stage. It aroused, one can be attained through consciousness. The Nataraja is surrounded by nimbus of glowing lights, which symbolizes the vast unending cycles of time.
other schools of temple architecture. Other schools of temple architecture.
Nayaka School. The Nayaka School of Architecture flourished under the Nayaka rulers in the period between 16th and 18th century AD. It was also known as Madurai School. It was architecturally similar to the Dravidian style but much larger in scope. It also had Islamic influence. Some of the unique features are presence of Prakarms or huge corridors in the portico around the Garbhagriha, along the roofed ambulatory passageways. The gopurams built under the Nayaka rulers were some of the largest gopurams. In Meenakshi Temple in Madurai was the tallest gopuram in the world. The art of gopuram reached its climax under the Nayaka style. The temple structure was filled with intricate carvings. Example, Meenakshi Temple, Madurai.
Versa School, it is also known Vesara School. It is also known as the Karnataka School of Architecture. It was conceptualized under the later Chalukya rulers in the mid 7th century AD. It combined features of both the Nagara School and the Dravidian School and result in a hybridized style. Some of the features are emphasis on the vimana and mandapa, open ambulatory passageway. The pillars, doorways, and the ceilings were decorated with intricate carvings. Three predominant dynasties who made Versa style temples were Chalukyas of Badami and Kalyani. Rashtrakutas 750 983 AD, for example, Kailasha temple in Ellora. Hoysala dynasty temples at Halebidu, Bellur. Influence of Nagara style in the curvilinear shikhara and the square base of the Vesara temple. Influence of Dravidian style is seen in the intricate carvings and sculptures, designs of vimana and step or terraced shikhara of Vesara temple. Examples, Doda Ba Sapa temple at Dambal, the Dakhan temple at Ehol, temple at Badami, etc. Vijayanagara School. The rulers of Vijayanagara Empire were great patrons of the art and architecture with capital at Hampi, Karnataka. They combined the features of Chola, Hoysalas, Pandyas, Chalukyas, and architectural styles. Under them, the architectural style began getting influenced by the Indo-Islamic style of Bijapur, which in turn was reflected in the temples built during this period. The features of temples were the wall of the temples were highly decorated with carvings and geometrical patterns. Gopurams, which were previously present in the front side, were also now built on all the sides. Monolithic rock pillars are there. Generally, temple pillars had a mystical creations yali engraved on them. The enclosing walls were larger. More than one mandapas were built in each temple. The central mandap came to be known as Kalyana Mandapa, dedicated to divine marriage. The concept of secular buildings inside the temple premises were also introduced during this particular period. Temple complex was enclosed by boundaries. Example, Vithala Swami Temple Complex, Lotus Mahal, Virushpaka Temple, Raghunatha Temple at Hampi, etc. Rock cut ideal of Narasimha and Sneha Snake at Hampi is marvel in itself. Hoysala art. In the region of Karnataka near Mysore, the temples built under the Hoysala rulers developed a distinct style of their own, known as the Hoysala school of art. It developed in the period from 1050 to 13,000 AD, with the prominent seats being Bellur, Helebidu, and Srinagiri. Some of the features of the architecture are multiple shrines were built around the central pillared hall. Unlike the crucified ground plan of the Panchayatan style, the shrines led out in the shape of an intricate designed star. This was also known as the stellate plan. Soft soapstone chariot Trist was the main building material. Massive emphasis was laid on the decoration of the temple through the sculptures. Both the interior and exterior walls were even with jewelries worn by the deities were intricately carved. At the chambers, all the chambers had shikharas, which were interconnected by an arrangement of horizontal lines and moldings. This resolved the tower into an ordinary succession of tiers. The temple was built on an upraised platform known as Jagati, which was about 1 meter high. The walls and stairs of the temple followed a zigzag pattern. Hoysaleshwar temple at Helebidu, Chennakeshwar temple at Bellur, Chennakeshwar temple at Somnathapura. Pala and Sena School of Architecture. The Bengal region, the style of architecture came to be known as Pala and Sena School of Architecture. It developed in the period between 8th and 12th century AD under the patronage of Pala dynasty and Sena dynasty. The Palas were primarily Buddhist rulers following Mahayana tradition, but were very tolerant to their patronized both the religions. Pala kings built lots of viharas, chaityas, and stupas. The Senas were Hindus and built temples for Hindu gods and also sustained Buddhist architecture. Thus, the architecture reflected the influence of both the religions. Monuments under the Pala rulers are universities of Nalanda, Jagadala, Adantapuri, Vikramshila. Somapura Mahavira is the magnificent monastery in Bangladesh. Monuments under the Sena rulers are Dakeshwari Temple in Bangladesh. The architecture of Sena rulers had the following features. Building had a curve or a sloping roof is a bamboo as in the bamboo huts. This became popularly be known as Bangla roof and was later adopted by the Mughal architects. Burnt bricks and clay known as terracotta bricks was the principal building material used. The temples in this region had a tall curving shikhara crowned by a large amalaka similar to the Odisha school. for the sculptures of this region, both stone as well as metal was used. Stone was the major component. The figures were unique in their highly lustrous finish. Siddheshwara Mahadeva Temple in Barakhar, temples around Bishnupur in West Bengal. Famous University of Ancient India, Udanta Puri in Bihar, Vikramshila in Bihar, Jagadala, Bengal, Vallabhi in Gujarat, Nalanda in, it was the most renowned university of South Asia. Takshashila, it is present in modern day Pakistan. Kanchipuram, prominent temples outside India. Angkor Wat, Cambodia. The world's largest Hindu temple, Angkor Wat, is situated deep in the jungles of Cambodia. However, it is just one of the many Hindu temples in Southeast Asia. The sea faring activities of the Chola Empire, Kalinga Empire, etc., brought the religion in these parts and gave rise to many Hindu dynasties. The Champa civilization in Vietnam, the Khmer Empire in Cambodia, and the Majapahit Empire in Java. The Angkor group of temples were built in the period between 800 to 1300 AD by the Khmer rulers. Surya Varman II is, however, credited with building most of the monuments. The architecture is very closely related to the Chola architecture, but has some distinct local flavors as well. Prambanan Temples, Java, Indonesia. The largest Hindu temple in Indonesia, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is dedicated to three Murti gods of the Hindu pantheon, namely Brahma, creator, Vishnu, preserver, and Shiva, destroyer. Pashupatinath Temple, Kathmandu, Nepal. Prehveria Temple, Cambodia. Hathas Raj Temple, Pakistan. Aditya Sun Temple, Multan, Pakistan. Architecture in medieval India. With Arab conquest in Sindh in 712 AD, the arrival of the Islamic rulers to the western frontiers of India had started by 12th century AD. The throne of Delhi had been occupied by the Islamic rulers, which marked the onset of the medieval period of Indian history. In the subsequent years, Indian architecture underwent a massive change. New elements such as calligraphy, ornamentation using inlay works, etc., were introduced to reflect the taste and the preferences of the new rulers. However, the local architects retained certain flavors of the local architecture, architectural traditions as well. Thus, the architecture of this following period were seen as a confluence to the Persian style with the Indian style. Hence, it is known as Indo-Islamic architecture or Indo-Saracenic architecture. Some of the features of Indo-Islamic architecture are given below. The use of arch and domes gained prominence during this particular period. It was also known as the Aryukid style. The Aryukid style of architecture and replaced the traditional Dravidian style of the architecture. The Islamic rulers introduced the use of minars around the mosque and the mausoleums. Mortar was used as a cementing agent in their construction. The Indo-Islamic architecture avoided the use of human and animal figures. While the Hindu architecture had been too congested, the Indo-Islamic architecture introduced spaciousness, massiveness, and breadth to it. While the previous structures used sculpture as means of decoration, the Indo-Islamic architecture used calligraphy as means of decoration. Arabesque method also used the decoration. Arabesque meant to use geometrical vegetal ornamentation and was characterized by continuous stem with split regularly producing a series of counter poised leafy secondary stems. The secondary stems in turn split again and return to merge with the main stem, creating a decorative pattern. The architecture of this period heavily used the principles of geometry, from decorative pattern to imbibing the sense of symmetry. The buildings had intricate jali works, which signifies importance of light in Islamic religion. An important feature of the architecture during this particular period was use of water in the premises of the constructions in the form of courtyard pools, fountains, small drains. Water was also used primarily for three purposes: religious purpose, to cool the premises, decorative purpose. The Islamic rulers introduced Charbagh style of gardening, in which square blocks was divided into four adjacent identical gardens. The architectures of these times also used the Preta Dura technique for inlay of precious colored stones and gems into the walls of the decoration. Another unique feature was the use of foreshortening techniques of the building, such as inscriptions appear to be closer than they really are. Difference between arcade style and tribaded style. Tribaded is characterized by use of lintel. So there is a lintel and it rests on two columns. In arcade, it is carried by use of arches and domes. So it have this arch, or they have this dome. Top, the use of shikhara on the top of the temple, they were generally conical or curvilinear. They used domes, generally hemispherical, on the top of the mosque. Minars were absent. Minars were present in the four corners of the mosque. Stone was the primary component of all the construction. Brick, lime, plaster, mortar started to be used for the construction. Architecture during the Delhi Sultanate. During the period of Delhi Sultanate, during the period of Delhi Sultanate, 12,000 to 15,026 AD, architecture can be categorized into two broad categories: imperial style and provincial style. Imperial style patronized by the rulers of Delhi, and provincial style was patronized by the local rulers and fiefs. Imperial style. The imperial style of architecture flourished under the various dynasties that ruled during this particular period. Each ruler imparted certain flavors of his own, but the broad stylization remained the same. Slave dynasty. The slave dynasty of the Ilbari dynasty remained in power from 12,000 to 12,090 AD. During this period, the style of architecture came to be known as Mameluke style of architecture. During this period, most of the constructions were remodeling of the existing Hindu structures. They are also started the erection of the number of monuments, Qutub Minar being a prime example. It is a five-story structure initiated by the Qutubuddin Aibak, who made only one ground floor. The next three stories were completed by the Itumish, and the fifth story was completed by Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Other example, Quat-el-Islam Mosque and the Qutub Minar premises, which were converted from Jain temple and Araidin Chopra in Ajmer. Khilji dynasty. They ruled from 12,090 AD to 13,020 AD and established a Seljuk style of architecture. The construction of this period were marked by the use of red sandstones. Also, the prominence of arcuate style begin from this particular period. Mortar began to be used prominently in all the constructions as cementing agent. Example, Alai Darwaza by Alauddin Khilji Sirji Fort. Tughlaq dynasty. It was the crisis period for architecture during the Delhi Sultanate period. However, some construction work were still undertaken which used grey sandstone. During this period, the focus was more on strength of the building, and so there was less emphasis on decoration. The constructions combined both arc and lintel method entrance design. They also introduced style of construction known as barter, which was characterized by sloping walls to give more strength to the building. Cities of Tughlabad, Jahanpand, and Firozabad. Lodi dynasty. Under the Lodi dynasty, architecture continued to take a backseat. Only tombs were commissioned during this period. However, more important feature of architecture during this period was introduction of double dome. It considered as a hollow dome inside the top dome. Double dome. The reason for the use of double dome were, first, to give strength to the structure, second, to lower the inner height of the dome. The tombs built during the phase were hard and bare without any lavish decorations. They were built in octagonal shapes, the diameter of roughly 15 meters. They were supported by a sloping veranda. Example, Lodi Gardens in the city of Agra was established by Sikandar Lodi. Provincial schools of architecture. During this period of Indo-Islamic style started to influence the local architectural style as well. The Bengal, Bijapur, Jaunpur and Mandu became most important seeds of architectural development. Bengal school. The Bengal school of architecture was characterized by its use of bricks and black marble. The mosque built during this period continued the use of sloping bangla roofs which was previously used for temple. Jaunpur school, patronized by Shariki rulers, Jaunpur became the center of great art and cultural activity. This style of architecture also came to be known as Shariki style and also avoided the use of minars as the Pathan style. A unique feature of these buildings were here the use of bold and forceful characters painted on the huge screens of the center and the side base of the prayer halls. Atla Mosque, Jaunpur. Example. Malwa School. The cities of Dhar and Mandu in the Malwa Plateau became prominent seeds of architecture. The most prominent feature of the buildings here was the use of different colored stones and marble. The buildings had large windows which could be a result of European influence and were decorated with stylized use of arches and pillars. Even the stairs were used to enhance the aesthetics of the construction. However, minars were not used in the school of architecture. The Malwa School of Architecture, also known as the Pathan School of Architecture, it is also one of the finest specimens of environmental adaptations in the period because of the following features. The use of large windows made the building and room well ventilated. Second, the pavilions were lightly arched, which made them airy and allowed the buildings to remain cool during the heat. Artificial reservoir known as Bowlies were constructed in the premises for storage of water. Locally available materials were used, so import cost was less. The use of barter system as introduced by Tughlaq made the buildings strong. Rani Roopmati Pavilion, Jahaj Mahal, Ashrafi Mahal are some of the examples. Bijapur School. Under the patronage of Adil Shah, Bijapur style or the Deccan style of architecture developed. He constructed a number of mosque, tombs, places, palaces which were unique in the use of three arched facade and bulbous dome and were almost spherical with the narrow neck. He also introduced the use of cornices. Cornices is this. his cornices. Use of cornices as special feature of the Bijapur school was the treatment of its ceiling, which were without any apparent support. Iraq clamps is a and a strong plaster of mortar were used to give strength to the buildings. The wall were decorated by rich carvings. An example is Gol Gumbaj in Bijapur or Vijayapura. Mughal architecture. Mughal architecture, the Mughals were great patrons of art and architecture. Under them, architecture regained its place of importance as new buildings were built with great vision and artistic inspiration. Babur undertook the construction of mosque in Panipat and Rohilkund, both constructed in 1526 AD. However, his region was too short-lived to inspire any new style of technique. Humayun's region was marked with a constant power struggle against the Sher Shah's fury. He couldn't focus much on art and architecture. He laid the foundation of a city named Dinpana, but couldn't finish it. Persian style became prominent in the architecture of this period. Sher Shah. During his brief region, Sher Shah built few monuments. He built the Qilla-e-Quna Mosque of the Old Fort Mosque in Delhi. He built the famous Rohtas Fort in Pakistan and Sher Shah Suri Masjid in Patna in Afghan style to mark his region. His period is a transformation from Lodi style to Mughal style of architecture. His period is transition from Lodi style to Mughal style of architecture. He also undertook the reconstruction and extension of an old Mauryan route. He renamed it as Sadak-e-Azam Great Road, which was later known as Grand Turak Road. He ensured adequate presence of saris and trees for travelers. Sher Shah Suri's tomb was built on his birthplace, Sasharam. It was made up of red sandstone and is situated inside a lake. The constructions under the Sher Shah continued the traditions of the Delhi Sultanate period. After Akbar ascended the throne of the Delhi in 1556, the golden period of the Mughal art and architecture started. Akbar took a keen interest in the development of art and architecture. The principal features of the constructions during Akbar's region was the use of red sandstones. He also introduced the use of Tudor arch, four arched arc. Some of the prominent construction works undertaken during Akbar's region are described below. Agra Fort. It was one of the first construction which started during the region of Akbar. However, most of the structures present inside the fort were done during the region of Shah Jahan. Some of the prominent buildings are Moti Masjid by Shah Jahan, Diwan-e-Aam, Hall of Public Audience by Shah Jahan, Diwan-e-Khas, Hall of Private Audience, Jahangir Mahal, Sheesh Mahal, Turkish Bath. The garden inside the fort are built using the Charbagh style. During the region of Akbar, more than 5,000 women stayed in his harem inside his fort. Fatehpur Sikri. One of the highlights of Indo-Islamic architecture was the creation of the new capital city by Akbar at Fatehpur Sikri. It was being described as the frozen movement in history, as the buildings here represent unique blend of Hindu and Persian style. Some of the important buildings inside the cities are Buland Darwaza, Salim Chishti's Tomb, Panch Mahal, Jodha Bai's Palace, or Maryam Uz जमानीज पैलेस, इबादत खाना, पचीशी कोट, हीरा मीनार, बुलंद दरवाज़ा, द इम्पोजिंग 40 मीटर रेड सैंडस्टोन स्ट्रक्चर वॉज बिल्ट इन 1576 AD टू कमेमोरेट अकबर्स विक्ट्री ओवर गुजरात. इट इज़ द हाइएस्ट गेटवे ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. सलीम चिश्ती स्टोम वॉज बिल्ट इन 1581 AD. इट वॉज ब्यूटिफुल जाली वर्क इन द वाइट मार्बल. इट हैज़ अरेबेस्क्यू पैटर्न्स विथ इंस्क्रिप्शंस ऑफ कुरानिक वर्सेस ऑन द वॉल. इट इज़ इन द इम्पीरियल कॉम्प्लेक्स विच ऑल्सो हैज़ बुलंद दरवाज़ा एंड जामा मस्जिद. इट वॉज फर्दर डेकोरेटेड बाई जहांगीर इन 1606 AD. पंचमहल इज अ फाइव स्टोरीड स्ट्रक्चर मेड ऑफ कॉलम्स एंड इंस्पायर्ड बाई द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ पर्शियन बडगीर विंड चार्टर विंड कैचर. जोधाबाईज पैलेस और मरियम उज जुमानीज पैलेस मैरी ऑफ द एज हैज़ अ ब्यूटिफुल इंटीरियर्स इन हिंदू मोटिव्स ऑफ बेल एंड फ्लावर्स. इबादत खाना अकबर यूज टू मीट लीडर्स ऑफ डिफरेंट रिलीजन्स हेयर टू हैव डिस्कशंस. पचीशी कोर्ट द कोर्टयार्ड वेयर अकबर सेड टू हैव प्लेड चेस. हिरन मीनार वॉज बिल्ट इन द मेमोरी ऑफ अकबर्स फेवरेट एलिफेंट नेम्ड हिरन. इट ऑल्सो सर्व्ड एज लाइट हाउस फॉर ट्रैवलर्स. इट इज़ यूनिकली डिज़ाइंड एंड इट्स एक्सटीरियर वॉल कंटेन्स टस्क लाइक स्पाइक्स. अकबर ऑल्सो बिल्ट टेम्पल ऑफ गोविंद देव इन वृंदावन. जहांगीर ड्यूरिंग द रीजन ऑफ जहांगीर आर्किटेक्चर टुक अ बैक सीट एज ही फोकस्ड मोर ऑन पेंटिंग्स एंड अदर फॉर्म्स ऑफ आर्ट. However, he oversaw the construction of some noteworthy monuments, including Akbar's tomb in Sikandra. Further, he developed a number of gardens during his region, Shalimar Bagh in Kashmir. He also built the Moti Masjid at Lahore. During the region of Jahangir, his wife Noor Jahan also undertook some major construction projects like tomb of Itmad Uddullah, father of Noor Jahan, being an excellent example. It was during this time the white marble became the chief building material, replacing the red sandstone which had been used until now. The tomb Itmad Uddullah was the first Mughal work made completely of white marble. It has some of the finest Pitra Dura work. Tomb of Jahangir was constructed by his son Shah Jahan at Lahore. Shahjahan. Under the Shahjahan, Mughal architecture reached its climax. Some of his principal works are described below. Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal is the finest specimen of Mughal architecture, exhibiting the full range of grandeur and opulence. It was constructed in the memory of his wife, Ajmund Banu Begum or Mumtaz Mahal. It had all the features of Mughal architecture, including the use of calligraphy, Pietra Dura work, foreshortening techniques, Charbagh style gardens, and use of water in the premises for decoration. Apart from this, some of the unique features of Taj Mahal are the jali work in Taj Mahal is lace-like and extremely fine. The carvings on the marble were low relief. Apart from Taj Mahal, Shahjahan constructed new number of other monuments, gardens and buildings such as Red Fort in Delhi, Jama Masjid in Delhi, Shalimar Bagh in Lahore, city of Shahjahanabad. Besides such large-scale construction, one of his best work was construction of Peacock Throne. That is one of the finest example of metal work during his period. Aurangzeb. During the region of Aurangzeb, Mughal architecture declined. Being a puritanical, he did not take any active interest in pursuit of art and architecture. Although Aurangzeb commissioned the construction of Bibi Ka Maqbara in the memory of his wife Rubina Uddurani, it is situated in Aurangabad and it is described as a poor imitation of Taj Mahal. During the Mughal period, two other styles of architecture developed in the region of Rajasthan and Punjab. Rajput style. The Rajput style of constructions of the period were also influenced by the Mughal style, but were unique in style and scope of their construction. They generally undertook the building of imposing palaces and forts. Some of the unique features of Rajput architecture are they used the concept of hanging balcony, jarokha, which is constructed in all shape and sizes. The cornices were built in the shape of an arc, such that shadow took a shape of a bow. Sikh style of architecture developed in the region of modern day Punjab. It was heavily influenced by the Mughal style and Rajput style of architecture. Some of the features are use of multiple chhatris or poiks on the top of the construction, use of shallow cornices and onion domes. The building had fluted domes, which generally covered with brass copper gates for decoration and support. The arches were decorated by the use of numerous foliations. For example, Sri Harminder Sahib or Golden Temple, constructed in 16th to 17th century. Architecture in Kashmir. Development of Kashmiri architecture can be broadly divided into two important phases of its political rule: earlier medieval Hindu phase and 14th century onward Muslim rule. No major monuments that were made prior to 1600 AD exist, except few Buddhist monuments like monastery and stupas now in ruins were discovered at Harwan and Pushkar. Temples in Kashmir. The Kashmiri temple architecture has its unique features situated to local geography and renowned for its exquisite stone carving. Due to its location on the important trade routes, the architectural style is inspired by many foreign sources. Temple making reached a great height under the rulers of Karkota dynasty and Utpala dynasty. Main features of Kashmiri style of architecture are terrefoil arches, Gandhara influence, cellular layouts and enclosed courtyards, straight edged pyramidal roof, column walls, Greek influence, triangular pediments, Greek influence, relatively more number of steps. Martand Sun Temple. It is located in Anantnag, Kashmir. It was built in 8th century AD under the aegis of Karkota dynasty ruler Lalit Aditya Mukhpeda. It is considered to be a synthesis of various schools of architecture. The influence of Gandhara, Chinese and Gupta can be observed in the monuments. The complex is in the shape of courtyard surrounded by columns. The main temple has a pyramidal top and carvings of gods like Vishnu, river goddess Ganga, Yamuna and the sun god is present on it. Temple at Avantipura. There are two temples, namely Avanti Swami of Lord Vishnu and Avantivara dedicated to Lord Shiva. It was built by the king Avanti Varman, the first king of Utpala dynasty in 9th century AD. The temple is inside a paved courtyard and has four shrines on it, four corners. The gateway has two chambers and is carved on elaborately Roman and Gandharvan influence is clearly found. Pandirthan Temple. It is also called Meruvardhana Swami and it is dedicated to Vishnu, but Shiva images are also exist over there. It was carved out of a single block of stone and has exquisite carving on its wall. It was made in early 100th century AD and is located near Srinagar. It has domed roof and arches. Mamleshwar Shiva Temple. It is located in Pahalgam and has built in around 400 AD. It finds mentions in the classic Sanskritic text Rajatangini. Jama Masjid in Srinagar. The iconic mosque was constructed in 14th and 15th century. It has a large courtyard and has 370 wooden pillars. Curved domes is notably absent, following the Kashmiri style of architecture. gardens in Kashmir. The Mughal king built a lot of gardens and were inspired by the Persian designs. They also constructed a charbagh style water streams, fountains and trees. The Mughal king built a lot of gardens and were inspired by the Persian designs. These were constructed by charbagh style water streams, fountains and trees from an important part of a garden. Shalimar Bagh. Shalimar Bagh was made by Jahangir in 1619 AD. It was the royal residence of the Emperor Jahangir during the summer months. It has three terraces named Diwan-e-Aam, Diwan-e-Khas, Zina Garden. Nishant Bagh is the largest Mughal garden in the valley. It is near Dal Lake and has 12 terraces. Badamwari Garden in Srinagar, Waring, Kokirang and Achabal Garden in Anantnag.
It's almost around 2 hours and I have taken in between 10 minutes of break and I'm able to complete around this much. So it was a quite a productive session, and still there are some topics which are left, like temples of Parsi community in India. Yes, only one is left. So I think let's study it and finish this entire so it is just this much. Okay. Temple of Parsi community in India. There are three major type of fire temples in Parsi faith. The first is Athash Behram, fire of victory. Second is Athash Adran, and the third is Athash Dadgah. There are 8 Athash Behrams in India and more than 100 Dadgahs, mostly located in Maharashtra and Gujarat. Athash Behram. The exterior is generally kept simple because idea is to hold sacred fire and Yashna ceremony prayers rather than the glorification of the faith. It has an inner sanctum where fire is kept. The structures have vent for the smoke to escape. The performance of ceremony is considered to be the highest order and involves elaborate arrangements. They are performed by the high priest called Dasturs. Athash Behram is the highest grade of fire and involves the gathering of 16 type of fires. 8 Athash Behrams fire temples in India are Iranshah Athash Behram, Udhava, Gujarat. It is in Gujarat, Mumbai. Modihin Kapli Athash Behram, Surat. Modern architecture. The arrival of European colonists coincided with the decline of Mughal Empire, which started a power struggle among the Portuguese, French, Dutch, Danish and British, which culminated into British rule till 1947. However, the Europeans also brought with them a wealth of architectural styles, which can be seen in the numerous constructions they undertook. Portuguese influence. The Portuguese brought with them the Iberian style of architecture. They initially built trading post and warehouses, which were later remodeled into the fortified towns along the coastlines. They also introduced the concept of patio houses, Borax style, developed in the late 16th century in Europe to express the strength of the church. It had elaborate, detailed and theoretical design to create dramatic effect. It involved use of contrasting columns.
say Cathedral Goa. Some of the notable constructions are say Cathedral in Goa, Basilica of Bom Jesus, Castella di Aguada in Mumbai, St. Paul's Church, Diu Fort, Church Est Ene, Teotihuacan in Goa. French influence. The French brought the concept of urban city planning with them. The French towns of Puducherry and Chandranagore, now Chandranagar, West Bengal, was built using the Cartesian grid plans and scientific architectural designs. They built imposing buildings as a show of power. They also introduced the concept of anonymous architecture, which involves simple facade without much ornamentation of design, much like modern building. French also developed coastal towns of Mahé, Kerala, Karikal, Tamil Nadu, Yanam, Andhra Pradesh. British influence. The British brought with them the Gothic style of architecture. It merged with Indian architecture and resulted in Indo-Gothic style of architecture. Post 1911, the new style of architecture is known as Neo-Roman architecture. Indo-Gothic style, also known as the Victorian style, was a unique blend of Indian, Persian and Gothic style of architecture. Some of the features of Indo-Gothic style are: the construction were extremely large and elaborate in their execution. The walls were thinner than the Indo-Islamic constructions. Arches were pointed, unlike curving arches of Indo-Islamic era. One of the unique features of the Victorian style was the use of large windows. Church has crucified ground plans. It adhered to advanced structural engineering standards of Britain. The steel, iron, poured concrete started being used. For example, Victoria Memorial in Kolkata, Gateway of India in Mumbai. Difference between Iberian and Gothic style. Iberian brick was the main material used by the Portuguese. Wood was used for roof and stairs. In Gothic, red stones and coarse limestones were primarily used. Iberian architecture. The Portuguese continued with their Western traditions and did not introduce any structural variations. In Gothic architecture, the British adopted Indian motifs and styles, gaining rise to the Indo-Gothic style of architecture. New Roman style. Post 1911 constructions undertaken by the British Raj were done according to New Roman style or New Classical style. The architecture of New Delhi, done by Edwin Lutens and Herbert Baker, were the finest example of the style. It has been described as Rome of Hindustan. The features of this phase are: the constructions were anonymous and without any interesting features. It was a confluence of all the style of architecture, which made the style conjugated and cramped with the space of artistic expression. Simplicity, modernity and utility were highly compromised due to the hybrid nature of the constructions. There were focus on circular buildings. They were also there was an overuse of oriental motifs to realize Western architecture designs. The concept of upturned dome can be seen in the top of Supreme Court, and Rashtrapati Bhavan was introduced during this phase. Post-independence architecture. After 1947, two schools of architecture emerged, revivalist and modernistic. However, both the schools could not break away from the colonial hangover. These has caused a decline in the standard of architectural traditions of India. For example, Punjab government hired Le Corbusier, French architect, to begin the design of the city of Chandigarh. Lauri Baker, known as architect of the poor. Lauri Baker was responsible for the revolutionized mass housing concept in Kerala. 2006, he was nominated for Pritzker Prize, dubbed as Nobel Prize for Architecture. Some of the features of his architectural style is construction of environment-friendly buildings by use of locally available material. Introduced the concept of filler slab construction to reduce the consumption of steel and cement. He also laid emphasis on the ventilation and thermal comfort arrangement. He is known as the conscience keeper of Indian architecture and the Gandhi of Indian architecture. Charles Correa. He is also known for his work in urban architecture and spatial planning. He adopted modern architectural practices of local sensibilities and needs. He has designed buildings like Madhya Pradesh Assembly Building, Mahatma Gandhi Memorial Museum in Ahmedabad, LIC Building in Connaught Place, New Delhi. He has awarded Padma Vibhushan in 2006. Thus, we see that from prehistoric times, art and architecture has found unique expressions in the life and leisure of the people of India. Greeks, Arabs, Persians, and Europeans, each of them had contributed in their own little way to the existing traditions, and the result is the splendid potpourri of Indian art and architecture. It is now almost 2 hours 13 minutes, and I have completed this entire section, Indian architecture, sculpture and pottery. So a lot of things I have read, covered, and I am left with some of the previous year questions for prelims exam. So I need to practice these particular questions, but I will do it tomorrow. So I'll just revise it once again, and then I'll practice it without I'll practice this question in a time bound manner. And I hope you guys have also enjoyed along with me this particular study session, and I hope your session was also productive and you enjoyed it. And if you guys, this particular initiative of mine, so please like the video, and if you have any doubts or you want some improvements or any changes in this live sessions, you can mention it in comment section below. I try to address them, and a lot of people comment me regarding please help me, or some other they have some other questions. So I would request to those people, you can join my live sessions, and whatever comments you'll be writing during the live sessions, I'll be answering there only. So it will be really good interactive sessions. So I hope that our live sessions will get more interactive in future. So thank you guys for watching this particular video, and have a great day and happy study hours.